gracious Father in heaven, we just pray this morning that you might send angels who excel in strength to push out Lucifer and his host, that the Holy Spirit will bless our greeting here today, our meeting, so that we can have freedom to worship Jesus in spirit and in truth. And we praise you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Please be seated.
Good morning. Beautiful Sabbath morning.
Amen.
God is good. Good to see each one of you here. I want to welcome those that are watching and listening in on the internet and other means of communication. We want to wish you a happy Sabbath also. Announcements. Well, we got quite a list of birthdays here. If you look on the back of here, that are this month, we had a very active food bank this past week, and we're so thankful for our volunteers that come and help us make that possible. Have prayer meeting on Tuesday night at 6 o'clock. There's a upcoming, there's a group come from Guymon that will be here in Woodward. Well, here, they're going to be here too also, aren't they? That group next.
Be here at 3 p.m.
3 o'clock next Sabbath here. We've got a memorial service for Ed Burnett coming up here in a week. Is there anything else that you can think of?
Yes, I have a couple of things here. If we could have the deacons hand out a little flyer here to everybody that would care for one. Thank you, gentlemen. We've been so blessed with a $1,400 donation from the youth of the Methodist Church. And here is Ellis County Food Bank stats. Would you give one to everybody that would like to have one? You know, we take it for granted that the folks who attend church here know all about it. But the fact is most people don't. Here are some demographics so that you know that this little food bank serves out of Arnett 20 homes on average, Fargo 12, 81 in Gage, 128 in Shattuck. That equals an average of 275 children, 224 middle-aged people, and senior citizens, 152. That sounds like a lot of people in a little county to me. And that's only made possible. Thank you, sir. That's only made possible because the generosity of people in our community, in our church, people just like you. Now, there's something else. Turn the page. In trying to find something that would help, no, not the real page. I'm talking about up here, this page. Trying to find something that would be of a benefit for Robert, one of our church members, that health has kind of been on the fritz lately. Our hospital, Newman Memorial Hospital, has a program called Senior Life Solutions. Now, folks, this is no little tiny thing. This is a great asset for people who are in the senior years. Things that have, they could use a little help in getting their, maybe the physical therapy put together, finding professionals to help them. That would be covered by Medicare. And we should really give this some real consideration. Here's one I need, difficult sleeping. Do any of you have a time getting to sleep? Some of you do. Here's another one. Life transitions, the loss of a loved one. Anybody lost a loved one lately? Well, of course you have. And it goes on and on. These are not just run-of-the-mill people that run of this and don't know what they're doing. And talking with our CEO, Mr. Hammett, Doran says, these are professional people that will help our folks have professional help, covered by Medicare.
And so most of you are probably on Medicare one way or another if you're of a certain age. And help is available because God has already made it so. I want you to know that's available. Thank you. I think that's all I have.
All righty. Our community, our hospital has come a long ways here in the last few years.
Praise the Lord.
Administrator, I noticed something last week as I drove by. Recently we put up a new sign there, the hospital. They landscaped it here last week and it just really dressed up the front of the building. And I had an opportunity here this week. I met the administrator in the hall as we were picking up our food for delivery for Meals on Wheels. And I told him how much I appreciated what they were doing at the hospital. I worked there for 25 years. Things have changed in 25 years. But God is good that we could have that facility here in Northwest Oklahoma. God is good.
Amen.
So with that, I'd ask you, we're going to go into our praise songs at this time.
Thank you.
in memory of Jimmy.
Let me just. Okay. Thank you. Okay. Give hope through your offering today. The impact of Hope Channel is evident in the inspiring stories of God's children like Pastor Ross and baby Aurora. Ross overcame drug addiction to become an ordained Seventh-day Adventist pastor after discovering Hope Sabbath School. Following baby Aurora's brachial plexus injury at birth, she was miraculously healed thanks to our Most Watched Let's Pray program and prayers on her behalf from our global community. With your offering today, Hope Channel can continue to share the transformational love of Jesus Christ with people all over the world by producing high-quality Christian content to reach new audiences in innovative ways. Our Hope Study platform is online and offers Bible studies on a range of topics. So far, over 300,000 people started a course just 1 year after the platform went live. People are hungering for Bible truth. As we read in Proverbs 11:25, whoever brings blessings will be enriched, and one who waters will himself be watered. By faithfully supporting Hope Channel International, you are not only blessing others, but yourself as well, by bringing hope to those who need it most, and by telling them the love of Jesus Christ. After celebrating 20 years of Hope Channel and reaching over 80 countries with the Adventist message, let's make 2024 the most impactful year yet in sharing hopes. Yeah, and sharing hope in Jesus Christ with people everywhere. Thank you.
Offerings, please stand. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for the blessings that you granted us. Thank you for the opportunity we have to return to you part of those blessings. Bless the offering, bless the gift and the giver alike in Jesus' name. Amen. Mileage is telling, don't get up, don't get down as easy as I once did. Invite you to take and turn your Bibles to our scripture reading this morning. It's taken from John chapter 17, verses 3, 4, and 5. John chapter 17, beginning with verse 3. And this is what it has to say. This is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorify you in the earth, having accomplished the work which you have given me to do. Now, Father, glorify me together with yourself, with the glory which I had with you before the world was. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading of his word and invite those that can and kneel to speak the Lord in prayer. Good morning, loving Father. Thank you for a beautiful Sabbath morning. Thank you for the sunshine of your love. Thank you for the blessings that you granted us this past week. And safety as we traveled, as we've done your work, as we've been your hands and feet. Thank you for Jesus and the plan of salvation, for the sacrifice that he made on Calvary in our behalf. Forgive, cleanse, strengthen, and fill us with the Holy Spirit. We pray for the Holy Spirit to be in our midst today as you walk up and down the aisles, that each one here might receive just the blessing that they need. Thank you for our guests. Thank you for your love. In Jesus' name, amen. Then share what God has on your heart for us today.
Go right ahead. I hope that doesn't drop too many times this morning. If you have your hearing aids in, it makes a really loud pop. If you don't have your hearing aids in, it makes a real loud pop. It's so good to see you. Wayne, welcome home. Daryl, Dorothy, welcome back. Painting a positive picture. I was visiting with the hospital CEO this week, and we were talking about what ifs and maybes and what could be and what the future holds, and we both come to a conclusion. If you want to get a community excited, we need to talk about a positive future. A person can't always run around talking gloom and doom and expect people to get excited, right? That reminds me, a few years ago, there was an overdue book returned in the book drop of a library 37 years late. And the name of it was Psychedelics. Psychedelics by Bernard Aronson, published by Humphrey Osmond. And there at the Riverside Library, they had even closed the library and started under another name. It was so overdue. Thirty-six years, 9 months, and 13 days. And on the book was a post-it note. Don't forget, the book was Psychedelics, checked out in the 60s. The post-it note inside the book said, "Sorry it's late. It's been a long, strange trip." I want to talk about that a little bit this morning. It was just a few years ago, and a fellow was kind of fast on his way, making his way along, and I don't have the time to talk right now. I'm on a mission. I got to keep. I'd like to visit. I'll talk to you later, but I got to keep going. I'm sorry. And he was just pressed on. You see, he had heard that Jesus had come and was now going to Cana of Galilee, where he had turned the water into wine, and he and the wife and the family, they were down at Capernaum. And they had a son. "Oh, my son's terrible sick. We've done everything we can to break the fever. Why, we put his hands in water. We put water on his forehead. We've turned him this way and that way. We've done everything that we know to do to break the fever. He's sick unto death, I tell you. He's not going to make it." And we decided that we'd heard about this Jesus. And he had made his way into Cana. We live in Capernaum, 16 miles away. And Mama said, "You get up there and see if you can find that faith healer. I hear that he can do impossible things. We got to save our boy." Have you ever felt desperate? You've done everything you know to do. And finally you go, "I don't know what else to do." They were at that point, and as he was walking along that 16-mile trip,
Good thing he wasn't my age and he didn't have Wayne's knees. 16 miles might not make it right now. And he came up there and he was had a an intensity, an urgency in his voice. If you have your Bibles, turn over there to John. John, and we're looking here in chapter 4. John chapter 4. Verse 46. Then Jesus came to Cana of Galilee, where he had made water turn to wine. There was a certain nobleman whose son was sick at Capernaum. When he heard that Jesus had come out of Judah into Galilee, he went to him and implored him to come down to heal his son, for he was at the point of what? Death. That's pretty sick, right? That's stage 4. If he's really that sick, that's stage 4. Point of death. Then Jesus said to him, unless you people see signs and wonders, you'll by no means believe. Now notice the word people. If your version has people in italics, people, that means it was added to the text. It's not in the original text. That's really important, because that means that the you was a plural you. A plural you. In Oklahoma, we'd say y'all. Y'all. But not everybody's from Oklahoma, I'm sorry to say. I implore you. Now, implore is not like ask. Implore is almost like what? Beg. Please come down. They were tight. They were family. They loved each other. Hope had flown out the window. This was their last chance. Now you see, the nobleman was a, Jesus was a stranger to the nobleman. But Jesus was, nobleman was no stranger to Jesus. Jesus knew him, but he didn't know Jesus. I just really think this is awesome. He didn't really know what Jesus had in mind. But you and I know Jeremiah 22:11, the last part of the verse says, that we may have a future and a what? And a hope. A future and a hope. He was talking to the future maker. He was talking to the hope presenter. Jesus said, unless you see signs and wonders, you will not believe. Doesn't that sound a lot like people today? They say, hey, you got to show me. But remember from last week's service, John is writing this book at the end of his life, written about 95 to 100 AD. He's the last of the disciples to be alive. Everybody else has perished, died in various ways that were hands-on, first-person witnesses of Jesus. And now John is writing for the second generation of believers who would never see Jesus. They needed to have confidence in Christ's word. That's where we are. We're just not second. We're kind of like, yeah, on down the railway. God's word transcends distance. God's word transcends circumstance. God's word transcends hopelessness. God's word has miracle working power. You see, John is talking to us. He says, God's word never fades. So you've got the Gospel of John, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, and Revelation written by John under the inspiration of Jesus, the Holy Spirit. And the whole book of Revelation is really about what person? Jesus Christ, according to the open verses. A revelation of Jesus. Because John wants us to know that this same Jesus that you've seen taken up into heaven will come in like manner as you've seen him go into heaven. He's wanting people to believe the word.
I'm afraid we, as a society of a nation, a world, are a little short on believing the promises. A little short. You probably read this week, unbeknownst to most people, science have begun conducting a secret experiment that involves shooting aerosols into the sky in the hopes of preventing global warming. Specifically, this is a solar geoengineering experiment in San Francisco that's trying to create brighter clouds that would, in theory at least, reflect the sunlight away from the earth. Oh, I hate to tell you, I'm happy to tell you this. Jesus Christ is the creator. If we're not careful, we'll just muck up things. By the word of the Lord, if you have Psalms 33 in your Bible, Psalms, Proverbs, Psalms 33. I start quoting it, you'll say, oh, I know that one by memory. You probably learned this as a child at home during your family worship or Sunday school or something. Psalms 33, 6 and 9. By the word of the Lord were the heavens made. I get a little in a hurry sometime. I still hear the pages turning. I cannot hear the of your fingers on your phone. By the word of the Lord were the heavens made, and all the host of them by the what? By the breath of his mouth. When we speak, words as a result of air or breath coming through the vocal cords, words. And then verse 9, for he spoke and it was done, he commanded and it stood fast. Isn't it nice to know there's something you can count on? God's love for you, his promises, it stands fast. If you have your Bibles, turn back to John chapter 6, verse 63. John chapter 6. John chapter 6. And we're looking down here at 63. It is the what? The Spirit that gives life. The flesh profits nothing. The what? The words that I speak to you are spirit and they are life. Now, folks, this is so important. This is so important. Could this book be in your library, the one that was checked out 37 years ago and you haven't seen it much since, and you're really tempted just to take it back to the library? Don't do that. Instead, let us ingest it. Let's read it. Let's believe it by the word of the Lord. There's power. And then if you have John 14:10, I'm running a sequence of texts here to prove a point. John 14:10. Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and the Father in me? The words that I speak to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does what? He does the works. He does it. He does it. The Father who dwells in me does it. So the words that Jesus is speaking, the promises that Jesus gives, the Father's authority is behind it. He's the one that sees it happen. sees to it. It's his omniscience, his authority. And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. Come here, Cain. Hurry. You got to come. My son's about to die. I know these other people are important, but come on, Lord. Come on. Come on. My son's dying. We've only got 16 miles to walk. Come on. It's important that we consider the helplessness, the anguish in this man's heart. Begging, pleading with the Lord to come. And it says here in verse 50 of John 4, Jesus said to him, "Go your way, your son lives." That's just as loud. Go your way, your son lives. Don't think about the fact that his son lives. Look deep within the heart of this man. See the hopelessness and the no tomorrow for the family's son vanish at the word, "Your son lives. Your son lives." You and I could say that. We're not even a doctor, so it wouldn't mean to do much. But Jesus said it, and the anguish evaporated. The anguish disappeared. This week we were in Oklahoma City. It seemed like we were over there once or twice a week. In Oklahoma City. On the way home, this urge struck us to stop at this strange store that sells shoes. Gentlemen, don't you just love going shoe shopping? You know they only have one thing in the whole store? Shoes. So we were in there, and I kind of looked around for a pair of shoes or two, and then what might be there, and all of a sudden my wife disappeared. And this little lady came up, real skinny lady. She came up, kind of looked at me and looked the other way, and made herself scarce, and then she came back around. She said, "Where's your wife?" And Marilyn, I looked at her and I said, "I bet you think I'm an old man that's lost, don't you?" She said, "No." She said, "You got that hat on." I had my Tilly hat, you know, with the wide brim hat on. I said, "Really?" She said, I suppose you're a gentleman. You look like a gentleman, that you're very nice, and that you take care of your wife and people." And went through this list. And the second time she started laying it on thick, I stopped and looked directly into her eyes. We were less than 3 feet away. And you know what I saw down deep in her eyes? Loneliness, hopelessness, a soul crying out for somebody to care. It sounded like she was coming on. She was expressing the heart's loneliness. Maybe she needed food. Maybe she needed a hug. Maybe she needed somebody just to listen. Come on, folks, can't we do that? Can't we listen? Can't we be encouraging to people? After all, I'm looking into your faces, half of you or more in here, give your lives to help feed those that you don't hardly even know, to sustain life. You are healers, you're givers. Hey, I know a man who once walked this earth, and he was a giver. He gave his life for his children, for the world. Come on, you've got to come, Lord. Come quick, come now, come, come. And Jesus paints this positive picture. This positive picture in just these words. Your son lives. Whatever your circumstance, turn it over to Jesus. Hope ignited in the mind of the nobleman this created picture. Today's spiritual battles is the same issue. Why do we find it so hard to believe? Now I'm going to ask some of you who are younger just to ask the older folks if you don't recall, but there was a time when we used to pay our bills, Pat, with a check. Some of us still do, but not as much as we used to. And we had faith that Clay and Debbie would pay that bill when my check came through the bank. And then time changed through the years, and we received a credit card, and some of us would put that credit card in a little swiper machine, and they'd lay a piece of blue light paper on top of a card in my paper and go, and you'd open it up and there'd be the numbers and the imprint on that credit card, That was a form, and we really believed that when those numbers somehow would be read, the bill would be paid. And then came the magnetic strip. I still got them in my credit cards, magnetic strip. Some places you go, and it reads it. And whenever it goes through, I guess Debbie or somebody goes, oh yeah, okay. Or maybe it's all automatic now. But that's gotten old now. And so now they have a computerized chip in the end of it. And you just go, and you take it out of the grass machine when they tells you to. You leave it in a little bit, and take it out. And there's something in there that reads that magnetic strip. And I'm so dense, I believe that there's money in the bank. Must be a lot of people who believe that. And not only that, last time I was shopping in Oklahoma City this week, you don't have to run the magnetic strip anymore, Pat. He's just taking you. You tap it on the machine, and something in there goes, it's got the information. And we believe that the bill's paid. We believe that the account is settled. Friends, I've got something more sure, a sure word of prophecy. Jesus Christ the Lord. It's more sure than a credit card. It's the surest thing of all. Men come and go, but the Word of God is secure, and it lasts forever. You see, actually, Jesus was ahead of his times. What we need is to believe with all our hearts in the Word of God. Believe. The account is paid. The devil's mumbo-jumbo is broken. And we have freedom to worship Jesus in spirit and in truth. And not only worship him, but to live for him. So John is writing to people like you and me. His voice has been in the grave now for centuries. But the Word of God stands forever. It stands forever. Christ's words for those of you who are theologians are present, active, indicative. Present, active, indicative. They stand forever. Heaven has not lost its power to save. Heaven, people need hope. People are weary of negativity. They need positive. In Christ, we have a future, and we are not orphans. We have hope. Well, I'm glad that kids aren't the way we used to be, because I used to be scared of the dark, Marilyn. I was almost brave in the daylight, but at night, I just had this phobia. There was something in the dark that was going to get me. And I had this thing outside my window on the farm. It was a mulberry bush. And it would scratch on the screen on the outside my window when the wind would come around just right. It would make goosebumps run up and down my back. And before I could come to my reason, my feet were running through the house. But I knew that you didn't run into Mom and Dad's bedroom in the middle of the night screaming, "The sky is falling, the sky is falling." So I would stop in the living room where there was a wall furnace. Only Marilyn probably remembers there was a wall furnace in the living room. And I would stand there and it would come on in the wintertime. And I'd kind of turn like a chicken on a rotisserie and get warmed because we were in the country. And I would hope beyond hope that Daddy would get up to use the bathroom and come find me. So the day came, the evening was there, all of this happened. And out of the clear blue, my father stood in the doorway looking at me. I was crumpled up in a little ball on the floor in front of the furnace trying to stay warm in the middle of the night and not be eaten by the boogeyman. He said something like this. He said, "What you doing?" I replied, "Something's outside my window." He took it in. He said, "Let's get him." I wasn't expecting him to say that. "Let's get him." Dad grabbed his rifle and like two commandos in their pajamas, we quietly slipped out the back door of the house. He whispered, "You want me to go first?" I said, "Yeah." "Which way?" he said. I said, "That way, around the east side of the house. Behind the lilac bush. It's by my window." With the rifle pointed like it had a bayonet on the end of it, we went through the blackness of the night, poking behind the bushes, side of the house, looking up and down for whatever that must be out there. There wasn't anything for miles when we lived out north. We were sneaking through the darkness as we checked high and low. The only thing we saw was shooting stars. Dad said, "Shall we go around the house and chase them plumb away?" I said, "Oh yeah, yeah, let's get them, Dad, let's get them." So we went into the house and came around by the sidewalk that went from the house out to the garage. Jesus said to the nobleman, which according to John was the second sign. The first one must have been the water turned to wine. This is the second sign Jesus gave. "Your son lives." It was like God chasing the fear out of a nobleman's heart. When Jesus says to you, "I got this." He's got it. He's got it. He's got it. You know you're safe. How's the song go? "Safe in the arms of Jesus. Safe on his gentle breast. Thereby is love o'ershaded, sweetly my soul shall rest. Here let me wait with patience, wait till the night is o'er, wait till I see the morning break on the golden shore. Safe in the arms of Jesus, safe on his gentle breast. E'er by his love o'ershaded, sweetly my soul shall rest." That's really what changes it all. Our hearts go from impossibilities of this earth to Jesus saying, "Your son lives. I've got this." The nobleman turns around and heads home, not particularly in a run, just heads home. The servants come and meet him halfway and say, hey, your boy's okay. Your boy's okay. The fever broke. And he says to the servants, "What time?" They said, "The seventh hour." And he knew that that's like 1 o'clock the way we figure time. He knew when it was. And the Bible indicates that when he got home, he told the story to the whole family. Don't you know they did? And they said, Dad, well, what did Jesus say? And he rehearsed the whole thing like at family worship when you tell how God has led you in the past and how we can have faith for the future. He told the whole thing. And the Bible says that the whole family believed. Some people think that we give away food because we love to work. We give away food to people because it's a way of showing people how much Jesus loves them. There are 1,000 ways to preach a sermon. The best is by showing it any day. Shall we not follow Jesus and accept the fact that he says, I've got this, your son lives. I want to be that kind of man. I hope you do too. Gracious Father, now please, bless us, keep us, inspire us. You've got this. So we pray that we might live our lives for you today, tomorrow, and always. As we leave this church service, may we find someone to encourage within the auspices or within the reach of our lives. In Jesus' name we ask, amen.